And so without further ado, I'd like to present to you John Singleton.
Donald. Give it up for Donald Bogle. I studied his books when I was in film school, and just to give you some kudos, I studied the books on Black Hollywood and stuff of what had come before, because I was, as anybody who knew me in film school, I was kind of like a really militant kind of guy. Like, I'm gonna go to film school and I'm gonna shake Hollywood up. And
you're saying you were militant?
Yeah, I was. I'm not militant at all. I made some money, so I'm a little more passive right now. You don't want me to be angry, give me some more money. So, but I studied your books because I was like, wow, okay, this is what I'm getting into, and seeing the tradition of what creative people of color have gone through. And so I was like, okay, if I'm gonna forge a path in this business, I'm gonna have to know what came before so that I can try to like do something different. So thank you very much for that.
Well, thank you, I appreciate it. John, tell us, with this film, I mean, sort of what it comes out of, I'd like you to give us some backstory on the film and on yourself. How you grew up, where you grew up, what you observed of the world around you.
Well, this film just really is, I say, is a film that I actually went to film school to make. It comes out of me growing up poor black in the South Central Los Angeles, growing up next to a drive-in movie theater, watching films pretty much without sound outside of my mother's apartment window. Slasher movies, blaxploitation movies, kung fu movies, the blaxploitation movies. Sometimes I always say that I was inspired to cinema because of Pam Grier's breasts. So that, you know, spurred me on. But you know, the story of Boyz in the Hood came out of really me and my friends actually going to films constantly, and we used to come up to the Chinese, the Man Chinese, as it was called here, and we catch a 204 bus up Vermont, and we go to Hollywood Boulevard, we walk the streets, and we go to the movies, and then we jump on the bus, and then on the way home, we talk about the movies that we saw, and inevitably, we would talk about our own lives, and you know, making fun of each other and all this stuff, and somewhere along the way, we start talking about, somebody should make a movie about what we go through, what we're seeing. And it was my three friends, Jimmy Ray, and my friend Michael Winters, who we all call Fatback, who was actually the real Doughboy. In the movie, it's Doughboy, but in life, his name is, we call him Fatback. He called himself Fatback. You know, he was heavy set. And he had the most personality out of all of us. He was real heavy set and dark and, you know, real Nick Roy features, but he had that mouth, and he had like, he could talk to all the girls, and the girls loved it. Like, he was like Biggie Smalls before Biggie Smalls. So,
tell us something. When you were at USC and this whole sort of program you got into, because it happened so fast for you. You got an agent early on at CAA?
That was when I was a senior off of this script. I went to USC film school right out of high school. I'd always wanted to attend there. My cinematic idols, you know, George Lucas, who seeing Star Wars sparked me to actually make films. My other cinematic idol, you know, Steven Spielberg, he didn't get accepted, you know. And I went into the writing program because someone told me that if you learn how to write a script, it's the cheapest way to make a movie, is to write it. And if you can write very, very well, then you know people will actually read your stuff. They'll leap off the page. It won't, you know, won't be boring. You know, you learn how to write, and they teach you in the program. You read various screenplays of classic films, and you watch the films. And then what I did with the program was, I just you know, I immersed myself into what everything it had to offer. I watched all the, went in all the screenings, I, you know, seminars, you know, and I helped out on the student projects. I just immersed myself into the lore of cinema. But at the same time, I was trying to find my voice, and it was in that time that Spike Lee had come out with She's Gotta Have It, just before I started film school. And so I entered film school with kind of a manifesto, like a black cinema, like, you know, we can, you know, we can change things with film, you know, make a change, you know, we can do something very significant in having an authentic black voice that's not sifted by a white male mentality. You know what I mean? Like, you know, something that's uncut and funky, like Funkadelic or James Brown or Marvin Gaye. But movies should reflect that. And so that was my, like, that's my militant side. I'm not talking about it. But I'm saying, like, I want to just do something cool and funky. I want to, like, that's my revolution, to do something that's different from the norm, you know? And so I ended up writing a few screenplays. I got a award for one, and then Boyz II Men was my second one. And that's how I got to have representation by CAA, which was at the time the biggest agency in Hollywood.
And so then what happened when the movie got into motion, when you found out that you were going to be able to do it? What transpired then?
What transpired then was was all the shit that I talked about. I'm going to make a movie out of school and all that stuff. I was scared. I was scared to death.
Really?
Yeah, I was like, oh my God, I really got to do this now, right? And so I locked myself up in an apartment, and I watched all the classic pictures that I loved, and I looked at my script. And
Which pictures?
Well, I looked at classic films, but I also looked at contemporary films that I liked at the time. A big thing was Gus Van Sant's Drugstore Cowboy, Hector Babenco's Pichot, which was always a favorite film of mine. But pretty much I watched in rotation the Godfather trilogy and Martin Scorsese's Taxi Driver. Mm-hmm. And what I would do is, I've watched the films also, you know, I was watching them on tape, but then when I got the deal to do Boyz, my executive, Stephanie Lane, you know, who I've worked with several times, I said, well, you know, I'm going to screen some films. And she said, fine, you know, screen some films, you get ready for your movie. And so what I would do is, I started using the screening rooms at Columbia Pictures as like my party thing. Like I would screen Taxi Driver, because it's one thing to watch a film on a TV or a monitor, but when you see it in a theater, you're seeing it the way the filmmaker actually wanted you to see it. So I watched Taxi Driver, but I didn't want to be alone, so I'd invite all my friends from the neighborhood to come to the studio. And we watched Taxi Driver, we watched Taxi Driver, we watched French Connection, we watched Raging Bull, we watched The Godfather, and after a while they were like, oh, you know, you're screening all these films, you know, and you're spending all this money. I said, how am I spending money? We're just showing the films. Well, John, you know, we gotta hire a guy who projects the films, and he's in a union, and he gets paid, you know, to like show you these films and stuff. And I said, well, damn, you know, isn't that what you guys do? Don't you guys watch films before you, like, I had no idea, no process, but don't you watch films before you make a film? Don't you watch good films before you're trying to make a good film? And then the guy said, okay, fine, no, go ahead.
So what was the first day of shooting like?
The first day of shooting.
What was the first thing you shot?
The first thing I shot, actually, the first day of shooting was in my own neighborhood in Inglewood. An area that's called The Bottoms, but it doesn't really exist anymore because they turned it into like mini malls and everything and stuff off of Century Boulevard. And I got there before the trucks got there. I got there before any of the crew got there, and it's near, not too far, it's on the west side in Inglewood. And the offshore layer, anybody from California knows, if you're in the west side of Los Angeles, even Santa Monica, Inglewood, and the west side cities, at certain times, the fog rolls off of the ocean. The fog rolls off of the ocean and rolls into the streets. And, you know, and so I sat there on the curb in my old neighborhood with all the different apartments. And I just sat there like, okay, psyching myself up. You can do this, you can do this, you can do this, mm-hmm. Right? And just as the morning is coming up and the call time's going, and it was around 7:30, 8 o'clock, the fog starts to break, and all the trucks start rolling in, the grip trucks and the camera trucks and all this stuff. And there's actually a picture of me that was taken that day, because they were doing a photo essay of different things in Black America, and one of the photographers took a picture of me on the set, the first, before I even say, you know, action, you know what I mean, the first thing. And so we get in, and then the crew comes up to me and say, okay, what are we doing first, right? And I had already taken the little kids that you'll see walking in the apartments. I had always taken them to do an on-set rehearsal a couple weeks earlier. And I took these little kids, and they were looking around like they were scared. They were like, "Oh my God, this neighborhood!" I was like, "Y'all just chill. We got this." You know, this folks I knew from elementary school around. And so the crew said, "You know, what's up? What do you want to do first?" And I said, "Okay, you kids go stand over there. You're gonna rock from right to left. We're gonna set dolly track. We're gonna set about 35 feet of dolly track right here, and we're gonna track them from left to right, right?" And I was just acting like I was a director. I didn't know what the hell I was doing. But I'd seen enough films that I saw a shot. I know that they have to, that's what the dolly was for, right? So they're going, you know, like you see like these tracking shots, you know, Spielberg does tracking shots, and, you know, various directors do tracking shots, and, Francis Coppola did these interesting tracking shots where he had adjuncts and stuff, and they're rising the boom and lowering the boom and stuff like this. So, like, I was like, I said, this is what I'm supposed to do. So my whole thing of that first day and the first few days was acting like I was a director. And I was like, you know, it just got good to me, you know, like the first day I got a crane there, and I was like, I want to get on the crane, right? I jumped on the crane, and I do a shot. You'll see when the kids in the opening go into the alley, it shows the street, Morin Street. That's where I grew up, on Morin Street, so I had to go from the sign into the alley, and I'm on a crane, like, you know, rise me up, you know, like this, and I'm just a kid, I'm, you know, just playing with these things, right? And so I'm acting like I'm a director, and then the dailies come the day after, and I'm watching the dailies, and I see the dailies, and it looks like a movie. So I was like, okay, I'm, you know.
You're a director.
Maybe I'm still scared, you know, something could mess up, right? Yeah. I could mess it up, it's my first time doing it. But as you watch this movie today, you'll see the films really aren't really shot in continuity. The producer of this picture, Steve Nicolaitis, he judiciously scheduled it in continuity, okay? Because he knew it was my first picture. And so what you'll see as the movie progresses, I get better and better and better at what I'm doing, you know? Because I'm trying different things. And most of it, yes, I'm sitting there doing Chavez and all this stuff, but most of it is me, I'm also thinking on the fly. I'm like, okay, we're gonna do this, we're gonna try this. And some of the shots I'm doing, you know, like when the little kid walks up the street, as you see, as some of you see in the picture, and he's walking and his mother's talking voiceover, and the guys get into a, they're playing dice, and then they're in the foreground, and then in the background, they get into a fight as he walks past them, you know. That shot is influenced by Travis Bickle walking up the street and Taxi Driver past the portal shot. Mm. See what I'm saying?
Yes.
You know, I had no idea what a long lens was, but I knew that I wanted him to be just like De Niro as he's walking up, this little kid, you know what I mean, with his head down, you know? That actually was one of the posters for Taxi Driver. And so as I'm shooting Boyz in the Hood, I'm saying, okay, this is gonna be like a Scorsese shot. This is gonna be like what Spielberg does. This is gonna be like what Francis does, right? And so I go at a period of time, and it goes about a week and a half in, and stuff, and he says, no, my DP says, no, this is a John Singleton shot. I mean, look, this is like, what's it? All right, well, we'll see.
Tell me this, what about the casting? Because I find it so interesting that the people in it have come to prominence that they weren't really known. I mean, Lawrence Fishburne had been around since a kid, mm-hmm. but you have Angela Bassett, Cuba Gooding Jr., you've got Morris Chestnut, you've got Tyra Farrell, who I really love, Nia Long, and
Ice Cube, yeah. Well, the thing is that I hadn't written the picture for only two actors to be in it. And an aspiring film student, I'm like, I'm gonna get Ice Cube to be in this movie. But it was Ice Cube and N.W.A. at the time. If you see the four guys on the porch in this picture, it was supposed to be Ice Cube always gonna play Doughboy. Monster was gonna be Dr. Dre. Rim was gonna be the Dookie. And Eazy was gonna be Little Chris in the wheelchair. And so what happened was Ice Cube and I had become friends while I was in film school. And you know, we would chop it up occasionally. He left the group. And so after he left the group, I was like, listen, I'm still doing this movie. I'm in film school. I'm like, but we're gonna do this movie, right? He's like, yeah, okay, I'll do your movie. You know, he wasn't taking me seriously, right? He had just got the deal to do his first album. And you know, we were talking it up and stuff. He left the group. I said, when I do this movie, you're gonna be the guy. And so he came in and he actually did it, you know, he did a semi-bad audition, his first audition, and he came back and did a good audition, and he rocked it, and you'll see it if you get the DVD and stuff. And then Fishburne, I had known because my first job in the business at 19 years old was working on Pee-wee's Playhouse. I was a production assistant. And I told Fish at the time, you know, I'm 19 years old, man, but I'm gonna write a movie for you. I'm gonna write you the best role ever. He said, okay, dude, all right, dude. But he says he always believed I was going to do it. So they came about, and then everyone else came from auditions and stuff, and Angela and Tyra Farrell came because Fishburne asked him, what are the two black actresses that you want to work with the most? And he said, Angela Bassett and Tyra Farrell. So I said, okay, fine, I'm putting them in the movie.
Did you have any issues at times in directing them?
No, not at all, because it was, I mean, we all were like, kids. I mean, Cube was 20. I was 22 actually when I directed this movie. Mm-hmm. Cube was 22. Nia Long was 18 years old. Cuba was the same age. He's the same age as me. He's 22. Morris was 21. Fishburne is only maybe about 9 years older than me. So he's playing Cuba's father, and he's only like maybe 9 years older than Cuba. You know, his young daddy's in the hood, so I gotta have a young daddy. That's the thing, like,
so you had a young father.
I had a young father, but, and it's something that we're seeing when we look at media and stuff, they always have the mothers, like, and when it doesn't matter if it's black or white or whatever, a lot of people, when they show black depictions of families, they always have the mother and father be so much older.
Yeah.
And that wasn't my experience. And people used to think my mother was my sister or my father was my brother. You know, my father was 17 when I was born. My mother was 18 when I was born. They were teenagers, right? Mm-hmm. So I was like, I gotta have that. And so I constantly do that kind of in my pictures, and it makes it look different. And so for a black audience, they're like, okay, I know that. That's me. That's, you know, that's my wife, so.
Were there any experiences with your parents that go into this movie?
Yeah, the galvanizing experience that actually with my parents was that when I was 11 years old, my mother told me, it was an early summer, a late summer day. It was 6:30 in the evening. It's light outside. You know, we got some old firecrackers. It's probably like after 4th of July, we got some fireworks we want to pop off. We're waiting for the night, right? You know, because we save fireworks out here. Just, you know, it used to be a thing. After 4th of July, whoever had the most fireworks after 4th of July that you could just pop off and everything, you would like fly. You know, you're like, why am I saying this? And so, we used to do, like, have little small, like, there was things called M80s. Anybody know what M80 is? Anyway, they're like, quarter sticks of dynamite. You put them in the cement. You took a cherry bomb. You jump behind the cars and everything. Like, do it again. My mother said, "Come in the house right now. You gotta go in the house right now. Whatever it is, you know, get away from the kids." And I was like, "No." She's like, "No." I said, "I don't want. It's light outside. Why do I want to go in the house right now? Right?" And she came out and she just tried to smack me. And I put my arm up like this, and she hurt her arm. And she said, ow. She said, you know what? You're going to your daddy. Mm-hmm. Forget this. You're going to daddy right now. So,
well, that's what went into the script, in essence.
Well, yeah. I didn't do it that way in the movie. But
no, but I think it's the whole
maybe movie. I'll do it in something else, you know. But
John, they're giving me, I can't believe it, a rap song.
A rap song? Okay.
But tell me what you think this film means to people today, because it's really endured. And I will tell you this, I've seen this so many times, and there is one scene in it that Spielberg commented on, I believe.
Yeah, exactly.
And that, I don't know if the audience has seen it before, but it's late in the film, I won't give it away, but it's in that.
It's just, this is a moment where you don't want to be in this room. There's a moment that is reflected that has happened in many, 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 many places in Black America where you just don't want to be in this room. And Steven Spielberg gave me a compliment like that's his favorite and see it in the picture, but
just when you see it, it comes very late in the film. And it involves the character Ricky. Very
yes, exactly. Late. But I think this picture, people really love this picture and reveal this picture because it speaks to their own experiences. You know, I've made this film, honestly speaking, for a predominantly Black audience. I didn't care if anybody else who wasn't Black was gonna see it. My attitude at the time when I was young was, you know, I can't rap, I'm not a rapper, but I'm gonna do the best hip-hop movie ever with no rapping in it, because it's the life that all that music comes from. It's the soul of where the people who wanna speak out and make music and do different arts come from, you know? And so that's what I actually wanted to do with this film. And actually kind of like show my own significance as a filmmaker by finding my own voice and doing something that was in the environment that I knew very best. And so what I always tell my students, my film students, or aspiring people who are in film, write about what you know. Even if nobody else cares about you and your environment, if you really, really specific about where you're from, somebody's gonna find something in it. But that's what it is. This was the first film, I think, in a very long time for Black audiences that was like so authentic. You know, there's not one of those things where like there's shades of gray, that there's no real villain in the movie, really. Like, you know, the cats that Doughboy runs with and his little crew are the flip side of the guys that are doing violence against them. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's the same, you know. So and there's a moment in the film, and we gotta go, where there's a retaliation thing, and when the audiences saw it in 1991, half the audience claps, and half the audience is telling people to shut up. Don't you see what they're trying to say, that there's Black on Black crime? So it's like, you know, because we're so engineered to celebrate the outlaw mentality with gangster movies and cowboy movies and everything as an American audience, when we see somebody get shot, we go, hey, we want to yay. But what I was doing was, I was kind of a double entendre emotional effect within a certain scene where you don't really want to celebrate the retaliation.
No.
You understand what
yeah,
I'm saying?
Yeah. Totally.
And so, and you know, you guys look at the news, you know, you see what's going on in the world, you know, in terms of whether or not it's the police, you know, or Black on Black crime between young Black men and stuff. This has been an ongoing thing. This was going on before Boyz in the Hood. And so this was my actual experience. So I gave voice to that within this film, and it ended up becoming a classic. And, you know.
By the way, in 2002, it was put on the National Registry as a film to be preserved, really. John Singleton, I want to thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Enjoy the movie.